Good morning, boys and girls. Today we have taken the topic of antiretroviral drugs for discussion. Before going to antiretroviral drugs, let us have some idea about HIV infection, AIDS, which is known as acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, its pathophysiology, and then we'll take up the way we are trying to treat different kinds of patients, the principles of therapy, different types of prophylaxis which are going to be given in case of HIV infection, and then at the end we'll discuss antiretroviral drugs. AIDS or AIDS is a collection of symptoms and infections resulting from specific damage to immune system, and it is caused by HIV in humans. Now, AIDS or AIDS was first reported on 5th June 1981 when the US Centers for Disease Control and Prevention recorded a cluster of Pneumocystis carinii or Pneumocystis xerovesi pneumonia in 5 homosexual men in Los Angeles. HIV infection is now pandemic, with an estimated of around almost 40 million people living with the disease worldwide. This data was basically taken around 2015-16, and many of them were actually died of AIDS since it was first recognized in 1981, and these things is making it one of the most destructive epidemics in recorded history. Likewise, you may relate something to COVID-19, but this HIV infection has been persisting for a very long time. HIV infections and its mortality is highly prevalent in sub-Saharan Africa, is followed by China, Eastern Europe and Asia. In India, it is estimated that almost 2.4 million people are currently infected, and its prevalence is really alarming in Manipur, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh. So even in West Bengal, you will see a lot of cases being reported in different centers. There are different HIV reporting center, like in Kolkata, for some region like Howrah and some area of Kolkata, IPGMR is one of the reporting center. Tropical medicine is one of the reporting center in Kolkata. But if you are going to a district, you will get a separate reporting center, block reporting center at Murshidabad. In that particular district, probably will get it in the Malda, which is these centers are working in relation with the medical colleges in the respective districts. These HIV is basically the etiologic agent of AIDS. The current CDC classification system for HIV infection and AIDS or AIDS categorizes patients based on clinical conditions which is associated with HIV infection, together with the level of CD4 T lymphocyte count. So one of the basic parameter which you have to see in case of HIV infection is CD4 T lymphocyte count. A confirmed HIV case can be classified in one of the 5 HIV infection stages, and those stages are 0, 1, 2, 3 or unknown. If there was a negative HIV test within 6 months of the first HIV infection diagnosis, the stage is 0, and it remains 0 until 6 months after diagnosis. Advanced HIV disease is classified as stage 3 if one or more specific opportunistic illness has been diagnosed. Otherwise, the stage is determined by CD4 T lymphocyte test results and its immunological criteria. If none of this criteria apply because of the missing information on CD4 T lymphocyte count, then the stage is unknown or abbreviated as U. The definition and staging criteria of AIDS are complex and it is comprehensive and were established for surveillance purposes rather than for the practical care of the patient. So when the clinician will get this kind of information about this, he or she should not focus on whether the patient fulfills the strict definition of AIDS, but should view HIV disease as a spectrum rather than it's a spectrum ranging from primary infection without the acute syndrome to the relatively asymptomatic stage to advanced stages associated with this opportunistic disease. This virus is basically a single stranded RNA retrovirus and found in two forms, HIV-1 and HIV-2. HIV-2 usually causes a similar illness to HIV-1 but is less aggressive. HIV primarily infects viral organs of the human immune system such as CD4 T cells, macrophages, dendritic cells. Virus directly or indirectly destroys the CD4 T cells, and usually it reducing this count to less than 200 per cubic millimeter. Normal range is around 500 to 1600 per cubic millimeter, and therefore the cell mediated immunity is lost. Each mature HIV variant is spherical in nature, and in the next slide we'll see its structure, which is basically has a lipid membrane and lined by a matrix protein. This matrix protein is embedded with glycoprotein linked to a transmembrane stalk GP41. Let's go to the next slide and visualize the picture of this variant. So this is the pictorial presentation of the variant, HIV variant, which is spherical in nature and has a lipid membrane lined by a matrix protein that is embedded with glycoprotein, and it's linked to a transmembrane stalk GP41. So two proteins are there, one is GP41, another one is GP120. Now at the right hand side in the picture you will see that there are the ways by which this receptor binding is being shown, how it's this HIV variant is binding to the CD4 T cells. HIV-1 binds to its target cell via the CD4 molecule. It leading to a conformational change in the GP120 molecule that allows it to bind to the coreceptor CCR5 for R5 normally we are using for this viruses. So two of the coreceptors are being shown, one is CCR5, another one is CCR4. Now the virus then firmly attaches to the host cell membrane in a coil spring fashion via the newly exposed GP41 molecule. This viral cell fusion, this binding the process of binding of the virus with the cell is called fusion, and it occurs as the transitional intermediate of GP41 undergoes further changes to form a hairpin structure that draws the two membranes into close proximity. So this is the way we are basically describing the initial structure of this variant. Beside this too, there are some other proteins like the GAG, which is polyprotein processed by PR imimatrix. There are some polymerase. It includes a variety of viral enzymes, including PR, RT. There is another one called VPR, that is the viral protein R. The one which is called RAV, it is basically the regulator of viral gene expression. There is another one called TAT, which is the transcriptional activator. There is called ENV protein, which is a GP160 envelope protein. LTR, which is the abbreviated form of long terminal repeat. VIF, which is basically viral infectivity factor. NAF, which is a negative effector, that is P27. It promotes downregulation of surface CD4 and MHC1 expression. And VPU, that is called the viral protein U, which promotes CD4 degradation and influences virion release. So out of all these, few of them are playing a key role, while the multiplication and the attachment and the other roles of the variants. The VPU is, as I said, it promotes CD4 degradation and influences virion release. It overcomes the inhibitory effects of tetherin, which is a normal protein, which is present, a protective protein present in the human body. The ENV, which is GP160 envelope protein, which is cleaved in endoplasmic reticulum to GP120 and GP41. And GP120 mediates CD4 and chemokine receptor binding, whereas GP41 mediates fusion, which has been shown here. And it contains RNA response element that binds to RAV. So this is about more or less the structure of the virion and the way it's binding with the CD4 cells. This picture is showing the global adult HIV prevalence rate around 0.8%, and the adult HIV prevalence in almost all over the world. And as I mentioned before, not only India but China, Eastern Europe, Asia, Sub-Saharan Africa, which includes South Africa, Switzerland, Zimbabwe, all are extremely affected countries. HIV infections can be transmitted in various ways. Mostly there are three main routes of transmission. The first one is the sexual contact with an infected person. So it's a sexually transmitted disease like syphilis, gonorrhea. And exposure, secondly, is the exposure to infected body fluids or tissues. It also includes blood transfusion. And the third one is transmission from mother to fetus or child during perinatal period. It is possible to find HIV in the saliva, tears and urine of infected individuals. But the transmission of infection through these secretions is minimal or yet not been established. So again, I am repeating, there are three main routes of transmission: sexual transmission, routes of transmission. Second one is via body fluid or tissues, which includes primarily the blood transfusion, and thirdly is from mother to fetus. The course of disease is usually not being seen at the initial stage. It is not manifest at the initial stage, and during the period of seroconversion, around 4 to 8 weeks, there is abrupt rise in the viral load with a substantial fall in CD4 count. And this is followed by the latent period, which lasts 7 to 10 years, during which the CD4 counts increase initially with a fall of viral load. So in the active phase of HIV infections, that is not HIV infections, rather the acute immunodeficiency syndrome ensues during which there is substantial increase in the viral load with associated fall in CD4 counts to as low as less than 200 per microliter. As CD4 cells are pivotal in orchestrating the immune response, any depletion makes the body susceptible to opportunistic infection and oncogenic virus related tumors. Disease, this HIV infection, as per WHO, can be staged into 4 to 5 types. Stage 1 is HIV infection, which is asymptomatic and not categorized as AIDS except for the presence of lymphadenopathy. Stage 2 is minor microcutaneous manifestation and recurrent upper respiratory tract infections. Stage 3, it is associated with unexplained chronic diarrhea for longer than 1 month, weight loss, severe bacterial infections, and pulmonary tuberculosis. Stage 4, usually the toxoplasmosis of brain, candidiasis of esophagus, trachea, bronchi, or lungs, and Kaposi sarcoma usually is manifested, all of which basically indicates acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. Before stage 1, a stage called primary infection exists for 2 to 6 weeks after exposure, which is symptomatic. The major manifestations of this stage are fever with rash, pharyngitis, and cervical lymphadenopathy. It may be associated with myalgia, arthralgia, headache, and mucosal ulceration. How will you diagnose these cases? A diagnosis of HIV infection is made by HIV tests, which include ELISA, Western blot assay, and detection of antibodies in serum, plasma, oral fluid, urine of patients, and dried blood spots. However, the window period, that is the time between the initial infection and the development of detectable antibodies against the infection, may vary. For this reason, it can take 3 to 6 months for seroconversion and for the person to test positive. So these in brief about the initial development or the nature of the disease and the way this acquired immunodeficiency syndrome develops. So in this figure you will see almost all kinds of opportunistic infections. It starts with candidiasis and the lungs, that means the pneumonia, the scan which is showing toxoplasmosis. It also shows different skin manifestations. Hence, these are the kind of opportunistic infections which are being observed with HIV infection and with AIDS. So, as I mentioned before, after entering the body, the viral outer glycoprotein GP120 of HIV binds to CD4 receptor on the surface of T lymphocyte. It also can be seen over monocyte, macrophage, and dendritic cells. This is followed by binding to other chemokine receptors on the cell surface, which has been shown in the initial slides, CCR5 and CXCR4. After attachment to CD4 and chemokine receptors, the virus fuses with the cell through viral glycoprotein GP41, and the viral contains like single stranded RNA and RNA dependent DNA polymerase. It is also known as reverse transcriptase, and other enzymes are also internalized. From the single stranded viral RNA, reverse transcriptase synthesizes a complementary strand of DNA and later a double stranded DNA. Many mutations can occur in the conversion of RNA to DNA, which are responsible for HIV's ability to develop drug resistance. The double-stranded DNA then migrates to the host cell nucleus and it's undergoing integration into the host cell chromosome by an HIV enzyme called integrase. Then comes the activation of cell,
by antigens or cytokines. HIV replication starts using host DNA polymerase. This enzyme transcribes viral DNA into messenger RNA, and mRNA is then translated into viral proteins. These proteins assemble beneath the host cell membrane, and then the viral nucleocapsid, this viral nucleocapsid, is formed surrounding these proteins, and the virus buds from the cell. That is called budding of virus. After budding, the virus maturation takes place. HIV protease enzymes basically cleaving it into smaller functional proteins. These enzymes are cleaving large polypeptides, and the smaller functional proteins are produced. These are newly formed virus which can infect other cells only after maturation. During this process of viral replication, the CD4 cells suffer from functional impairment, and the patients develop a defect in the cellular arm of the immune system. Impaired cell-mediated immunity makes the patient susceptible to opportunistic infection. The antibodies to HIV developed in 2 to 8 weeks after the infection. The virus basically is killing or is killed by cytotoxic T lymphocytes, or it undergo apoptosis. However, within some cells, they may stay as dormant and for years. The incubation period is estimated to be 1 to 7 years. So most of the subjects remain asymptomatic carriers for prolonged periods and can transmit the disease. And only a few develop a short febrile illness. The next stage is of high rate of viral replication in lymph nodes and the development of a persistent generalized lymphadenopathy with or without infections such as oral candidiasis and herpes zoster. In this final stage, the body cannot replenish. The patient suffers from opportunistic infections like candidiasis, tuberculosis, Zivorace, pneumonia, cryptococcal meningitis, CNS toxoplasmosis. So repeated chronic GI infections, these are all manifestations of the final stage. It also includes Kaposi sarcoma. And here you see at different stages we have shown these drugs are going to be obstructing the replication of virus in various ways and at different stages. So there are some drugs which can block the initial chemokine and CD4 receptors, that means the co-receptors, and those drugs are, one of such drug is maraviroc. We'll come to the discussion of the drugs at the end of the whole discussion. Then comes the one which may inhibit the fusion of the virus with the CD4 cell, and that drug is called enfuvirtide. Unfortunately, before fusion, we cannot prevent this virus to come inside or in giving entry inside the cell, because there is no vaccine developed in till now against this retrovirus. Then you may prevent this kind of reverse transcription by giving two different groups of drugs. One group is called nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors, and the other one is called non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors. The example of nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor is zidovudine and lamivudine. Non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor is nevirapine, efavirenz. So these are non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors. Beside these two, there is one more group existing and working at this region, that is called nucleotide reverse transcriptase inhibitor, and that drug is tenofovir. Then there is one group called integrase inhibitor, which is preventing the integration. It can be given alone, or it can be given one drug which is basically not an antiretroviral drug, but you can always prescribe that drug with raltegravir. Raltegravir blocks the enzyme HIV-1 integrase needed for viral DNA insertion into the host genome. So what drug you can administer with this raltegravir or similar drug like elvitegravir like thing? That drug is known as cobicistat, COBICISTAT. This cobicistat is not an antiretroviral drug. It is basically a pharmacokinetic enhancer and it's basically causing inhibition of cytochrome P450 enzyme system, specifically CYP3A4 and CYP2D6, and it also inhibits P glycoprotein. And these raltegravir, elvitegravir or raltegravir are mostly metabolized by CYP3A4 enzyme. So if you co-administer cobicistat, it will increase concentration of elvitegravir or raltegravir, and once daily administration can be formulated. So these type of combination is only contraindicated if the drugs which are metabolized by CYP3A4 like statins are also prescribed. Next comes the group called protease inhibitors. These protease inhibitors are being shown at the end following budding. It's basically inhibiting the protease enzyme, and lopinavir, ritonavir, these kind of drugs are belonging to the group of protease inhibitors. So these are the different types of inhibitors which are commonly prescribed in case of HIV infections. And the current trend is to begin combination antiretroviral therapy with 2-NRTI plus a third drug, or the third drug can be either NNRTI or ritonavir boosted protease inhibitors. Ritonavir is also a protease inhibitor, but it has a toxic effect, so it's giving in a very low dose. Just like cobicistat, it will increase the duration of action of other protease inhibitors. So it is kind of causing booster therapy and reducing the dose of other protease inhibitors. And previously, we used to emphasize the treatment with a term, and we used to call that take heart at heart. The first heart stands for HAART. It means highly active antiretroviral therapy, which is basically either the combination of two nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor plus one non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor, or it can be two nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor plus one protease inhibitor. We'll see it in the later slides. And the second heart is HEART, that is heart. And you have to memorize these highly active antiretroviral therapy or the basic regimen or the initial regimen which is prescribed in case of HIV infection or AIDS as the first line one. And different concepts are being there. Previously early treatment was not advocated, but nowadays the early treatment is advocated even in case of HIV infection. To improve the adherence of this antiretroviral therapy, single tablet fixed dose combinations are nowadays available, and they improve long-term compliance and help to reduce the viral load and emergence of resistant strains. So previously we bothered much about resistant strains, so we used to defer our treatment. Nowadays, having the same concept in mind, we can start early treatment but with a combination therapy and keeping the patient's compliance in your mind. One such single tablet once daily combination includes four drug therapy with elvitegravir, cobicistat, which is not an antiretroviral drug, tenofovir and amtricitabine, which is basically a drug
like lamivudine, which is belonging to nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor. There are different types of problem with antiretroviral therapy. The one and most significant one is abbreviated as IRIS. I, capital I, capital R, capital I, and capital S. The full form of IRIS is immune reconstitution inflammatory syndrome, and especially happen in patients with advanced diseases having subclinical mycobacterium and fungal or viral infection. It may last for few weeks to a year, and it needs therapy with specific anti-inflammatory agents. So this is all about the first part of, rather the first part of discussion related to HIV infection, AIDS, its basic pathophysiology, its entry, relatively the basic site of action of different drugs. And in the next lecture, we'll come up with the principles of drug therapy, different types of prophylaxis, and we'll discuss in brief about different antiretroviral drugs. Thank you so much for your patient hearing.